Hello, everybody. Welcome to the College of Complexes. My name is Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening. We don't have our microphone here tonight, so you all will have to listen. I'll talk loud and try to make myself heard. Of course, I'm not going to be the real talker. The real talker or speaker tonight is going to be this gentleman right here, David Ramsay Steele. David Ramsay Steele is the author of Atheism Explained, which is down there on the table in front. The title of his lecture is Everyone's Rational. The theory that some people are irrational is mistaken, but not itself irrational. So David Ramsay Steele states that I will argue that everyone is in fact rational and that irrationality is a mistaken but not irrational accusation. I will show that Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, Nazis, and Communists, and yes, even people who believe in rule of law.
Yay! Oh, thanks, Tim.
We live in a world where everyone accuses everyone else of being irrational. That is to say, they accuse people they disagree with of being irrational. You know, when new atheism erupted in 2003, 2004, especially with Sam Harris, the new atheist, I'm an atheist, but I'm not a new atheist, I'm an old atheist, as you can see. The new atheists attacked the Christians and the Muslims for being irrational. And of course, the Christians and the Muslims, especially the Christians, returned the favor.
Thank you.
And said that the atheists were irrational. There is, in fact, a best-selling book called The Irrational Atheist by Box Day. And it's quite natural that the Christians came back and said that the atheists were irrational, because, as I'm going to demonstrate, irrational means I disagree with this opinion. Now, in the world in which we live, there is a constant drumbeat of propaganda for the idea that everybody's irrational. I just mentioned there's a few books on the subject, which sell quite well, and go through several editions, and are very widely read. Predictably Irrational, The Hidden Forces That Shape Our Decisions, by Ariely, 2009. Sway, The Irresistible Pull of Irrational Behavior, by Braffman and Braffman, 2008. Irrationality, Why We Don't Think Straight, by Stuart Sutherland, 2007. Now, I'm interested in books, but it's not just confined to books. It's feature articles in magazines and newspapers, TV shows. I was surfing the cable channels the other night, and I saw a program called Your Bleeped Up Brain. And it was just full of examples of how your brain makes a fool out of you and misleads you about the world. So, there is out there a constant stream of propaganda for the idea that human beings are irrational. Now, what about the other side? Well, I've looked into this. There is a book called The Myth of Irrationality, which I read recently. And it's a very good book, but it hardly covers what I'm going to cover tonight. It's more about the history of philosophy and beyond. However, there is this book, The Myth of the Closed Mind, Understanding Why and How People Are Rational, by Ray Scott Percival. And Ray Scott Percival is a very deep thinker, and quite a good writer, or at least the writing's very patchy. In some places it's brilliant, in other places it's not quite so hot. But it's a book that I strongly recommend, The Myth of the Closed Mind by Ray Scott Percival, and I will repeat some of the ideas from it in what I'm about to say. Well, one of the reasons why the new atheist boom happened in 2003-2004 in the way that it did, in my opinion, is it was a response to 9/11. And it was the American leftist intelligentsia coming up with a story of how they would react to the event of 9/11. And the story they came up with was this. These people who blew up the Twin Towers are irrational religious nuts
And they are just like the moral majority, the Christian coalition, and all these right-wing Christians that we've been fighting all along. They're the same irrational religious people. So Sam Harris wrote that book, which became a huge bestseller, arguing that there's something irrational about religion. So what I want to do, first of all, in tackling this whole idea of irrationality, is to look at belief systems such as religion. Now, one thing that happened in the West after the Second World War was people began to notice that there were lots of minority groups putting forward strange ideas. Some of these were religious, some of them didn't proclaim themselves to be religious. There was Scientology, there was the Moonies, there was Mormonism, there was Jehovah's Witnesses, there was Hare Krishna, there was Rajneesh, who became Osho. More recently, there's been Falun Dafa. There was Objectivism, there was General Semantics, there was S. All these new cults sprang up. And so you've got a literature appearing about cults, and you've got the beginning of a profession of people who call themselves deprogrammers. And they, what would happen is some teenager would go and join some weird belief system, some weird organization. His parents would become concerned, or her parents, and they would bring in the deprogrammer. They'd kidnap the kid, lock him up in a room somewhere with the deprogrammer for a week or two, and undo what the cult had done to his mind. And the whole premise behind this was that he hadn't made a decision and chosen something that he believed in, that something had been done to him and he was powerless to resist, and you merely had to reverse this process by deprogramming. So there was a whole literature appeared about cults and what was wrong with cults, and there were disagreements about whether this group or that group was a cult. And if it was a cult, then it was much worse than if it wasn't a cult. So, for example, the Roman Catholic Church is never described as a cult. Although many of the things that one might say about cults would be true about the Roman Catholic Church, but it wasn't called a cult because it was huge. The biggest religious denomination in the world, and one of the biggest in the United States. So people didn't call it a cult. Now, people who adopt a belief system are adopting a whole new way of looking at the world. Let's say someone becomes a Jehovah's Witness. Let's say some 18-year-old listen to someone talking on a street corner about the Watchtower Bible Society, and they think this it convinces them. They go to a few meetings, then they join, they become a Jehovah's Witness. Well, they've adopted a belief system, and this belief system commits them to all kinds of views about things that they don't really know much about. I mean, for example, it commits them to a certain view of biological life. It commits them to a rejection of Darwinism and the idea that the Earth is very old and that things have been evolving for millions of years. So one might be tempted to say that this is irrational. They've swallowed a whole belief system. And they can't possibly know much about it. There's something irrational about this. Now, my view is that what happens in that case is essentially what happens whenever people adopt a belief system. So, when people adopt Christianity, or Marxism, or Buddhism, or Jungian psychoanalysis, essentially what goes on is the same thing that goes on in the mind of that 18-year-old who becomes a Jehovah's Witness. There isn't any substantial difference. Furthermore, I maintain that it's the same thing that goes on when a scientist accepts a new theory. When Einstein's theory was of relativity, special relativity and then general relativity were being propounded at the beginning of the 20th century, some physicists could never accept it and they died off. And that's one of the ways that science progresses. People who hold the old theories die off and they get replaced by people who, like younger people who hold the new theories.
Like global warming?
And those people who did accept Einstein's theory of relativity, they usually said, this is an amazing revelation. It's nearly always when you accept a new all-encompassing theory like that, it happens in a flash. Now, there may be a long period in which you study it, and there may be a long period in which you don't fully admit to all your friends that you've accepted it, but the actual process of conversion usually happens in a flash. And that's what happened. And of course, we're familiar today with the idea that science develops by means of paradigm shifts. And a paradigm shift is what happens in science when suddenly some genius propounds a new way of looking at things, and everything, when you look at it this way, looks different. And the person who put this forward, Thomas Kuhn, in The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, he's quite a controversial figure in the philosophy of science, and I certainly don't accept everything he says, but I do think that this bit of his description of what actually happened historically is correct. That's what happened. You have paradigm shifts. Now, so I'm going to maintain that all these belief systems and the changes in belief systems are very similar, whether you're dealing with religion or psychotherapy or politics or science. And I think this is because human beings have a hunger to believe, and they have a hunger to believe what they take to be the truth. Now, let me say a little bit more about these cults, these new religions. When people started noticing that there were a lot of these new cults around, and you can see the same thing has gone on more recently in Russia and China as went on in the 50s and 60s in the US. And that is, people wake up to the fact there are these strange new cults. You know, after they got rid of communism in Russia, they said, okay, we're going to have freedom of religion now. People are free to do whatever they like. But of course, the people who said this thought that everybody would be Orthodox, except for a few Muslims in the south, and maybe the occasional Roman Catholic. But what they found was that there were Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses and Baptists and all kinds of strange people pouring into Russia, eager to disseminate these very weird ideas that weren't really. And people who were atheists said, well, we can understand that Christianity, Orthodox Christianity, or Catholic Christianity, or Islam, these are religions, but these are strange things. These are not proper religions. So they started passing laws, cracking down on these odd new religions. And one of the things that happens when this occurs in a society, when people wake up to the fact there are these strange new cults everywhere, is that they tend to overrate the power of these cults. There's plenty of evidence that any organization that represents a body of ideas, in other words, any organization that disseminates a belief system, has a considerable rate of turnover. People who become converts in all these cults, in all these belief systems, they have a cycle of zeal. It's rather like a marriage. They start off being extremely enthusiastic, and then they come to terms with some of the difficulties, and they react in various ways. One of them is to leave. Another one is to turn it all into a routine without much enthusiasm. There are different ways of handling it. Another one is to transition into a new relationship to try to recapture the thrills of the beginning of that last relationship. And people, of course, there are some people who do that, going from religion to religion or political group to political group. They're all looking for that love at first sight, which they hope will they'll find a version of it which will go on forever. Now, if you cast your, if you're over 40, as probably most people in this room are, and you cast your mind back about 20 years, and think about people you knew 20 years ago who were involved in some peculiar belief system, it could be Maoism, or it could be Mormonism, or it could have been Est, now, or it could have been Krishna Consciousness, the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, the Hare Krishna crowd. If you do you know where those people are now? Because you'll find that in the majority of cases, they're no longer identified with that same belief system. They have changed. And it's characteristic of attachment to a belief system that it goes through this cycle. And people burn out and they drop out. Now, I'll tell you a personal story. When I was in the early... In the early to mid-60s, I was a Marxist, and very active and enthusiastic proponent of a certain type of Marxism. And I went to this university in England called the University of Hull in the northeast of England. And I was in the sociology department, and almost everybody who had a position in the sociology department, in other words, a lecturer, which is what we would, in this country, would call a professor. Or most of the graduate students, they were all Trotskyists, right? It sounds hard to believe. The range of opinion was from Ernest Mandel to Tony Cliff. That was the diversity of thought in that sociology department. Now, there were one or two who were outside that, but they were very careful about what they said. About 20 years later, after being 20 years away from that sociology department, I had to go back. I'd been living in the United States. I'd been living in Chicago for quite a while at this point. And I had to go back to the University of Hull, to the sociology department, to be examined for my PhD, because I took a long time to complete the requirements for the PhD. But so it was 20 years had passed. And it so happened that because of the conservative government's clampdown on higher education, cutting back on the universities, it led to this situation where a lot of professors in universities clung on to their jobs, because if they moved, they'd have to retire. So it so happened, because of this, that a lot of the people who had been there at the beginning of the 70s were still there at the beginning of the 90s. And they were going to be examining me on my dissertation. And I thought, oh, I don't stand a chance, they're all against me, all these Trotskyists. And so I walked, and I knew who they were, I knew them by name. So I walked into the room, and there was one external examiner, and he was my hope, because they hadn't picked him. I'd sort of nominated him, and he'd been picked. And I knew he'd be on my side. And it turned out that every one of these Trotskyists had long since not been a Trotskyist. Some of them were in the Labour Party, some of them were in the Social Democrats, some of them were even more the Liberal Democrats, as it had become. Some of them were even more right-wing than that. But none of them was a Marxist of any kind. And what I'd written, they more or less agreed with. They didn't agree with libertarianism. I'd become a libertarian by this time. But they did agree that socialism as conceived by Marx was not a practical proposition. I listened to them say things, and eventually I said in sheer astonishment, I'm the only ideologue left, because I'm still a tough-thumping libertarian, but all you former Trotskyists have become something else. And around the same time when I visited London, I had a debate with a member of the Socialist Workers' Party, which was the biggest Trotskyist group in Britain at that time. And it was quite a well-attended debate in London. And quite a big crowd of Socialist Workers Party supporters came. And there were people outside selling the Socialist Worker their newspaper. And they greatly outnumbered the libertarians who were on my side. But the interesting thing was this. The speaker and two or three of his friends were people who I knew had been in the Socialist Workers Party way back, in fact, before it was called the Socialist Workers Party in the 60s. And so you had like three or four people who were about my age. And then all these other Socialist Workers Party supporters, the oldest of them must have been 25. Most of them looked about 19. So the interesting thing there is what happened to the people who had been selling the Socialist Worker at such meetings in 1975, 1980, 1985. Where were they? Où sont les neiges d'antan? So this is typical of these ideological movements, that they have a actually we've spent quite a bit of time analysing the Communist Party of Great Britain. The Communist Party of Great Britain was founded in 1920 and wound up in 1991. And it had many fluctuations in membership. The highest its membership ever was immediately after the Battle of Stalingrad, understandably enough, when it was well over 60,000. In almost every year of its existence, the turnover rate of membership was over 10%. And some years, it was over 30%. So people join movements, and they drop out. Now, I'm a libertarian. I don't have much to do with the Libertarian Party for a number of reasons. But I'll bet you, if you go to a Libertarian Party chapter or branch or whatever they call it, like the one here in Illinois, I bet you'll find that it's headed by three or four people who've been in it for 20 or 30 years. And that everybody else has been in it for less than 10 years. Because that's the typical pattern with organizations that promote a belief system. So there is scholarly support for this kind of vague impression. Eileen Barker, who did some research, found that at least 61% of those who joined the Unification Church, which is the Moonies, during a four-month period in 1978, had left the church within 2.5 years. Levine, in his 1984 study of over 800 members of religious movements, found that over 90% had left within 2 years. Bird and Reimer did a study in Montreal. They found that 75.5% of participants in new religious movements were no longer involved 5 years later. The defection rate ranged from 55.2% for transcendental meditation to 100% for the Church of Scientology. That's all the people who joined the Church of Scientology in Montreal in at that period had left a couple of years later. Now, I think we can say that that's true of small unconventional religious groups, but it's also true of small unconventional political groups. But it's also true of major movements. If you look at the rise of Christianity, for example, I think it's very interesting that in the very first independent historical reference to Christianity, which is a letter from Pliny the Younger to the emperor, in 112 of the Christian era, the year 112, and he's writing to the emperor, he's governor of a province in the Roman Empire, he writes to the emperor, he says, there are some Christians here, and they're real troublemakers, and they get up before dawn and start singing hymns to Christ as to a God, Christus quasi Deo. And what should I do about them? And the emperor wrote back and said, well, this is what you should do about them. But the interesting thing to me about that letter is he mentions that there are people who had been Christians and had left, were no longer Christians. That's the very first historical reference, independent of Christianity, to the existence of Christianity. 112, Pliny the Younger. And he mentions that there are people who have been Christians who have left Christianity. And that was true throughout the history of Christianity from the earliest times until the conversion of Constantine. You know, in other words, when you see in history that a movement of opinion is gaining ground, you have to realize there's always a dropout rate. There are always ex-members of that, whatever it is. And if it's gaining ground, it's because they're making converts a little bit faster than the people are leaving. So what happened, of course, was that in 312, the emperor became a convert to Christianity. And then very quickly, it became very hazardous to life and limb not to be a Christian. So everybody had to be a Christian, or they would be tortured and killed. Now, prior to the conversion of Constantine, it's been estimated by historians that Christians were 10% of the population of the Roman Empire. So in other words, in the open forum of debate, Christianity only made it in the Roman Empire to 10% of the population. At that point, the emperor became a Christian, and shortly after that, it became hazardous to life and limb not to be a Christian. And the reason that we've heard of Christianity today is because of torture and killing, because it was too expensive, too costly, not to be a Christian. So to me, the interesting thing about this is that people look at the history of Christianity, and the same with the history of Islam, and they say, this irrational idea suddenly took hold. Well, no. This irrational idea took hold among 10% of the population, and then people got power in the state and used it to make everybody else obey. This irrational idea would have blown away in no time if it hadn't been for the use of state power, the torture chamber, and the cross, in fact, the execution, to encourage people to support this belief system. So, far from being a story of a virus spreading from mind to mind, it's rather different. Now, another thing about people who join belief systems, adopt a belief system and join an organization, is that you see that these organizations are always prone to splits. And what does that tell you? Well, what it tells you is it's not so easy to maintain conformity. That ideological movements always tend to split. There are over 1,000 religious denominations in the United States today. To pick something at random, the last time I looked, which was a couple of years ago, there were 12 Mennonite denominations in the United States. They'd split at some point in the history of the Mennonite faith. They'd split over some point of doctrine, and they'd never got back together again. And it's much harder to get together again than to split. here again, we see that it's not so easy to control people's minds and make them believe one thing, because people develop their own opinions. They become argumentative. They start thinking that maybe the leader isn't right. And so you have splits. So what all these observations tend to bring out is that if you look at a belief system, especially when it's in its early enthusiastic phase, you can easily be over-impressed by its strength. Another thing that you should take into account is this. When people abandon their adherence to a belief system, typically, what do? They keep quiet about it. They've left the church in here, but they keep going to church. And they don't tell their friends that they've left the church in here. And there are many, many examples of this. When I ceased to be a Marxist in the early 70s, there was a period of at least 18 months where I didn't tell anybody. I kept quiet. Here's a straightforward, interesting example. You may or may not have heard of someone called Frederick Cruz. Frederick Cruz is a literary theorist and a literary critic, and he became famous because he pioneered the use of Freudian psychoanalysis in literary criticism. He wrote books about American authors, Hawthorne and people like that, Melville, based on a Freudian interpretation, a psychoanalytic interpretation. Later, he became the most rabid anti-Freudian in the United States and became almost like a professional anti-Freudian. But what's interesting is there was a period in between, quite a few years, where he just kept quiet. So when people lose their conviction, they don't immediately tell, usually, they don't immediately tell the world they've changed their mind. So what does this mean? It means that if you look at some belief system, it's a lot less powerful than it looks. It can be religious, it can be political, it can be psychotherapeutic. It can be any kind of belief system. Let's say that one of your friends joins some kind of cult. And then, because they're your friend, they try to get you into it. And you start meeting a few members of this cult. And you meet, let's say, over a period of a few weeks, you meet 20 members. And they all mouth the same phrases. And they're all marching in lockstep towards a glorious future. And you think, wow, this is a powerful force in the world. But statistically, you can be sure that two or three of those 20 people have already left in here. They just haven't told anybody. They've burned out and they're about to drift out. And you can be sure that 20 years later, most of those 20 will no longer be in that of that persuasion. You know that in the 1940s, there were a number of people in the United States, two the most striking, Whittaker Chambers and James Burnham. Whittaker Chambers wrote a book called Witness about his experiences as a communist spy who then changed his mind and became an anti-communist campaigner. James Burnham was a communist, then a Trotskyist, then he became very right-wing conservative. And he wrote a book that was published in the 40s called The Struggle for the World. And he says in that book, and many people were saying the same thing at that time, we've got to do two things quickly, because we don't have much time. The first thing is we've got to bomb Russia before they get the bomb. We've got the bomb, they haven't got it, we've got to bomb them. And it's not, to do this would not be a declaration of war, because they've already declared war on us. Furthermore, they're winning. Furthermore, they're winning.
Good idea.
The other thing he said was, we've got to unify the United States and the British Empire to take world leadership, because there has to be a world empire. And we've got to make sure it's not communism. It's got to be us, right? Now, George Orwell reviewed this book of James Burnham. And George Orwell didn't know about Whittaker Chambers, although his friend Arthur Koestler knew a lot about Whittaker Chambers. They were friends. But George Orwell reviewed this book by James Burnham, and he said, well, this is very compelling, very convincing argument, and maybe we ought to do something like this, because it is really a terrible threat, communism. And they are trying to take over the world. He says, but wait a minute. Think of all the communists you've ever known, and ask yourself whether they're such a formidable force. Well, first of all, most of the communists you know are no longer communists. They've left. They burn out and they leave. And he goes on like this, and you realize that Orwell is right. That no matter how evil communism was, and no matter how determined it was to take over the world, it wasn't as powerful as it seemed to James Burnham. And incidentally, it wasn't as powerful as it seemed to William Chambers. So people tend to be too frightened by the apparent strength of belief systems in their rising phase. They're actually paper tigers. They actually have much less power behind them, especially if they don't manage to seize the reins of government and impose a monopoly of their beliefs on everyone. If, as long as they are in the secular marketplace where they have to defend themselves against other beliefs, then they're weaker than they look. Okay. Now I want to turn to something which a lot of people think is absolute proof that there is a lot of irrationality in the world. And that is suicide terrorism, where people kill themselves in order to kill some of the enemy. The common view is, and this is certainly the view of Sam Harris, is that there's this irrational force called Islam which causes people to destroy themselves and others out of sheer hatred for the way other people are. Now, there's an interesting book which I strongly recommend that you read by Robert Pape, who's at the University of Chicago. It's called Dying to Win, and it's a study of suicide terrorism. He wrote this book in 2005. I haven't checked to see whether there's a new edition. There probably is, but I haven't checked. And he made a database, a detailed database, of all terrorist actions anywhere in the world from 1980 to 2003. Now, in the period from 1945 to 1983, strange though it may sound, there wasn't a single act of suicide terrorism anywhere in the world. There had never been suicide terrorism in the Muslim world, never. There had been suicide terrorism in Europe in the 19th century when anarchists and people like that blew themselves up in order to kill some public figure, but never in Islam. In 1983, there were American troops in Lebanon. Hezbollah got a few of its operatives to fill up a truck with explosives, drive it into a US military base, and blow the whole thing up. They blew up themselves and it killed a lot of American military personnel. Now, I've always thought that Ronald Reagan was no fool. Because what did Ronald Reagan do? Pulled all the troops out of Lebanon. Very, very sensible. But exactly what Hezbollah wanted. This was a huge success. And it was a huge success partly because it was involved suicide. Because if you're prepared to die in the commission of the terrorist act, you can do a lot more damage. Secondly, the fact that you're prepared to die is itself a frightening thing. Really intimidates people. So Pape looked at what happened. After 1983, terrorist organizations all over the world started adopting suicide terrorism because it worked. And in fact, he shows by his analysis that 50% of suicide terrorist acts achieved their objectives, at least in part. Which is a phenomenal, when you think that terrorists are a bunch of, usually a couple of dozen people, and they're taking on the strongest military powers in existence, the United States and the State of Israel, and they manage to achieve their goals 50% of the time, that's an amazing success rate, just amazing, and far greater than would be achieved by ordinary non-suicide terrorism. So that's why suicide terrorism spread after 1983, was because it worked. It was a demonstrated, successful technique. So not only was it rational, it was optimal, because it got results. So martyrdom can be a purely rational technique. And incidentally, footnote here, some people think there's some connection between self-interest and rationality. But that's a fallacy. You can be rational
about any goals at all. Rationality is having appropriate goals to achieve the ends you desire. It is not necessarily self-interest. Self-interest is no more rational than altruism. Or for that matter, self-destruction, although very few people want that as an end in itself. And suicide terrorists would rather not commit suicide if they could get the same results without it. Now, incidentally, the biggest perpetrator of the biggest group to perpetrate suicide terrorism when Robert Pape wrote his book in 2005 were the Tamil Tigers. More acts of suicide terrorism and more deaths had been done by the Tamil Tigers than by anybody. Tamil Tigers represent the Tamil ethnic group in Sri Lanka, what used to be called Ceylon, little island off the southern coast of India. And the members of the Tamil Tigers have Hindu backgrounds, and they're all atheists. They're Marxist-Leninists, and therefore atheists, and extremely hostile to religion per se, theistic religion per se. So much for Sam Harris's idea that it's religion that makes people irrational and therefore engage in suicide terrorism. And the goals of these suicide terrorist groups, for the most part, are political. And it's one of the points that Pate makes in his excellent book is that if you look at the parts of the world where there are most Islamic fundamentalists, like Pakistan and Nigeria, you don't find any suicide terrorists, or very few. And what distinguishes parts of the world where there are suicide terrorists is that they are ethnic groups who see themselves as being under military occupation, either by the United States or by the state of Israel. As you all know, in September 11, 2001, Al-Qaeda organized or facilitated the organization of an attack on the Twin Towers, in which over 3,000 people died in New York City. Now, the people who did that were all Saudis. And they made no secret of what their objective was. Their objective was to have all American troops withdrawn from Saudi Arabia. 19 months after 9/11, in March, or maybe it was the first week in April, I've forgotten that, but around that time, 2003, something happened that was not given a huge amount of fanfare and that you might be forgiven for having overlooked. All American troops were withdrawn from Saudi Arabia. So not only was 9/11 not irrational, it was hugely successful. It achieved exactly what it set out to achieve. And that, by the way, you can be fully rational and make a mistake and blunder and not achieve your objectives. The fact that you failed doesn't mean that you're irrational. But not only was 9/11 entirely rational, it was well calculated to achieve its objective, and it did achieve its objective. Now, turning to more prosaic matters, there are these books that say, usually written by psychologists, who tell you that human beings are irrational. And I'd like to mention a few of these. Now, I do have a piece of equipment here that I'm going to show you. I've forgotten that I have this. At least I thought I had it. Here we are. Anybody know what this is?
DF37?
This is this is one of the experiments which shows how irrational people are.
And this is an experiment done by a man called Wason. I always think it's unfortunate because people think his name must be Watson. But it's Wason, W-A-S-O-N. He did this experiment. And before I tell you what the test, it's a simple test. And you give a simple answer. And the point is that it's a very simple test. But 95% of people given this test give the wrong answer. Okay? Now, you have to imagine that these are four cards that you can turn over. I put it on a sheet of legal paper so that I can hold it up and show it to you. Right, but you have to imagine that these are four cards. And you're told that there is a letter on one side of every card and a number on the other side of every card. Okay? And the test is this. What you have to do is, I'm going to try and get this right. You have to turn over any number of these cards in order to test the following hypothesis. And the hypothesis is that if there is a D on one side, there is a 3 on the other side. That's the hypothesis that you have to test. But you're not allowed to just turn over all the cards, right? You have to turn over exactly those cards which will enable you to test that hypothesis. Okay? Now, over 90% of people...
Skip it.
There are always a handful of people who get it, who come up with something really screwy. But over 90% of people will say that the answer is D and 3. And that's the wrong answer. Okay? The correct answer is D and 7, as I'm sure all of you understood. And so that's Wason's experiment, and it shows that human beings are very irrational because they can't do this simple, they can't complete this simple logical task successfully. another famous experiment that's become legendary, because I heard about this in the late 60s. And I was given a very garbled version of it, is the experiment done by Solomon Ash. What happens in this experiment, the experiment has been run 1,000 different ways, but the original pristine form of it is this. You get people together and you say that you're going to do this test, and you've got about 9 people. Now, in reality, yes, all but one of those 9 people is a collaborator with the experiment, and only one of them is the real subject of the experiment. And everybody else is acting a part for the benefit of this one person. He doesn't know that. He thinks that there are 8 people in the group who are just like him, and the one person is actually administering the test. And the test is to look at a line on a piece of paper, and then look at a bunch of lines, usually 3 lines, on another sheet of paper, and say which line is the same length as this line. Right? Now, the people who are pretending to be subjects of the experiment, but are actually collaborators with the experimenter, most of the time, they give the right answer. But some of the time, they deliberately, all together in unanimous agreement, give the wrong answer. So they'll say that this line here, which obviously isn't the same length as this one here, is the same length. And I forget the percentage, but a very high percentage of these individuals in this position, in this first run of the experiment, will say the same as what everybody else is saying. And that was an experiment conducted by Ash, A-S-C-H, Solomon Ash. And the way I heard about this in the 60s, late 60s, when I was studying sociology, and the way it was explained to me was, well, this shows that people's perceptions of the world depend upon consensus. They depend upon the social group. well, that's an idea. But
Well, why don't we get a chance?
It turns out, from running this experiment in different ways, that that's not true. And one of the simplest ways to test that is, you see, the people have to say in front of everybody else what they think is the line of the same name. Well, one simple way to test for part of this is to do it privately. Take each person away. Well, really, only one person, because he's the only person who's being tested, and ask him what he thinks. And what you find then is that his disagreement with these people shoots up, and his tendency to get the right answer shoots up. So in other words, what's going on in that kind of situation is not primarily that people perceive the world the way the group perceives the world. It's primarily that they know a mistake is being made, but they don't want to go along. They don't want to stick out. They want to conform, which is a very different thing. In other words, it's not true that people can't see which lines are a certain length if other people are urging them something different.
Thank you, sweetheart.
But it is true that many people don't want to disagree with the rules. And one variant of the test, the person who is the real subject of the test has somebody join him. One person joins the group who is also a stooge, but who contradicts the others and says the correct answer. And again, in that situation, the one real subject's correct score goes shooting up. So it only takes one person to support you if you're up against a huge majority. One of the other things they found is it doesn't make any difference how many people you add. It can be 8, it can be 20. It doesn't matter how many additional people you add. The results are more or less the same. So the experiment, as it's been often talked about and by word of mouth has spread in sociology departments and other benighted places, doesn't show what people think it shows. And it doesn't show that people are incurably irrational. Now, there are quite a number of experiments. If you read Dan Ariely's book, and by the way, these books that say that everybody's irrational, we're going to prove it by giving you all these psychological examples from experiments, most of them are very, very good books and full of really interesting stuff. And you could easily have written those books instead of saying, this is more proof that everybody's irrational. You could have written them saying, here are some more curious quirks about the way people's minds work. But of course, they wouldn't have sold them because there is an appetite out there to be told that everybody's irrational. People love to be told that. It's the ruling ideology. Everybody's irrational. There are a couple of points. I could run through some of these experiments and say make some criticisms of them, actually. But I probably don't have time. One thing I would say is this, that a lot of what a human being does is done thoughtlessly, without thinking. For example, if a really expert piano player is playing a piece on the piano, they don't think about what fingers are hitting what notes. When they were learning the piece thing, they marked up the piece with fingering, and they followed that fingering, but now it's second nature. They don't think about that. Unless something goes wrong. And then they may study a particular couple of bars and rethink it, and maybe change the fingering. When I'm walking along the street, I don't think about where I'm putting my feet. It's all very automatic. So a lot of what people do is automatic pilot. And that's the only way it could be, if you think about it. The only way an intelligent, rational, calculating brain could have evolved was in a context where all these things happen automatically without thought. Now, that doesn't mean that the things that you do thoughtlessly and out of habit or out of instinct are not subject to rational control. You can, if you wish, always intervene and change. For example, I often find, and I found it this year, due to this wonderful global warming that we have, that there's lots of snow and ice, and my shoes, as the winter goes on, and I walk the length of the loop several times a day, because that's what I do. There's lots of salt on the sidewalks and in the roads, and after a few months of this, my shoes start to separate and they start to leak. And at the same time, there's lots of slush and pools of melted slush. So I don't want to get my feet soaking wet, so I step around these pools. So I intervene by calculation to change what would otherwise be an automatic habitual process. And we can all do this with any automatic habitual process. We can reevaluate at any time whether to behave thoughtlessly and on automatic pilot, or whether to interpose some new calculation. And I might add, it isn't always good to interpose that rational calculation. That would be completely paralyzing and destructive of your life. You have to allocate most of what you do to the automatic pilot. And if you start studying every little detail of what you do, you will die of starvation before you get very far, far from anything else. So you don't prove that people are irrational by saying that they rely on habit and automatic pilot. There is a choice to be made, and we make this choice all the time, from minute to minute, whether to intervene in that automatic pilot, override it with the conscious pilot, or to leave it to the automatic pilot. And we can make a mistake in either direction. We can fail to intervene where we should intervene, I'm assuming here we have certain goals of efficiency and effectiveness that would mean that we would consider. We could fail to intervene where we should intervene, but we can make a mistake in the other direction. We can do too much thinking where we should leave it to the automatic pilot. And a lot of these books that give you psychological experiments that show that people do things habitually irrationally, what they do is they will give you one of the examples is that people react differently if something is free than if it is just reduced in price. Even though in one context they might save more money by going for the one that was reduced in price, they treat the case where something is free, even though the difference in what they spend is less, they treat that as somehow privilege. Now, what's going on here? What's going on here is that people haven't got all day to think about all these stupid little choices. They want a simple formula, a simple algorithm that they don't have to think about. And it's not enough to show that that algorithm can lead them astray. What you've got to show is that it would lead them astray in a sufficiently high number of cases to mean that it's not a good algorithm to use routinely. So a lot of these psychology examples don't prove what they're supposed to prove. And I may say here, they think that if it's not optimal, it's irrational. Well, it could be not optimal, it's still rational. It's just not the best choice. Doesn't mean you're not being rational. But even proving it's not optimal is not something they've done. In order to prove it's not optimal, you would have to take someone in a whole host of situations over a long period and watch them applying that rule of thumb repeatedly, let's say to 1,000 cases, and then compare that with somebody using a different rule of thumb. And you might find that some of these things that these psychology
of popularizers tell you, suboptimal are really optimal. I mean, one of the examples that one of these people gives, or it's actually the Brahmins, a lot of the people who write these kinds of books tend to be Israelis, I don't know why. But in the Brahmins book, you've all heard of Joshua Bell. He's one of the country's leading violinists. And as an experiment, Joshua Bell wore very drab working class clothes and went and played his violin, which is a $55 million Stradivarius, on a street corner. And everybody just walked past without paying any attention. And this, and the Brahmins give this as an example. They say, well, this shows something they call value attribution. That people are, people would, if he was wearing a tuxedo, and he had a bunch of photographers around, people would have paid more attention or would have listened. Now actually, most people who walk the streets and pass strolling musicians would never dream of going to hear a violinist play, a classical violinist. So it's dubious even on that level, but let's suppose it's true. What does that really show? It might be that this value attribution, in other words, judging a thing by the way it's presented, does work 99% of the time. Or if not 90%, 99% of the time, 80% of the time, 85% of the time, who knows? They haven't done that. They haven't properly proven that it's suboptimal. It might be that going by flashy appearances is a good, optimal method. They have, even if it's not, even if it's suboptimal, it's still not irrational. It's just not the best possible method. So, I've coined my own, there's usually a term for each of these faults of departures from rational thinking which people commit. But I've coined my own, and this to bring out a particular point, and that is the man bites dog effect. What would have happened if everybody had stopped and clapped Joshua Bell? What would have happened? We'd never have heard that. And every day people are making lots of effective decisions that work for them. And what these people are doing is they're finding that odd occasional example where people do something that doesn't look too good. And this is, as they used to say, journalists used to say, dog bites man is not news, man bites dog is news. Well, man bites dog certainly piques interest and is worth talking about, but it's exceptional. It's not the routine. So people are signaling to me that I should finish, and since I'm a rational being, I'm going to accede to their requests.
All right. All right, we get into the question and answer period now. I would like to remind everybody once again that all questions must end with a question mark. Well, you can remain standing, Mr. Steele.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Because you'll be the one answering the questions, not me.
If he wants to sit down, we can still get him.
I'll call on people. So if you have a question, raise your hand. I see he's got his hand up already. I'll call on people, and of course, Mr. Steele, being the speaker, is going to answer, not me. All right, I'll start with you, Ernie, because you had your hand up first. Go ahead.
You talked about falling into belief systems just because of you're in the environment and so forth. Would you consider democracy one of these belief systems? That was your question. And secondly, support of athletic teams, does this constitute a belief system? And thirdly, can we say on any level that Cubs fans are rational?
So I can answer those right away?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Well, of course, democracy is an element in belief systems. People believe in democracy, and some people don't. And there are different meanings of democracy. And there is,
democracy where we take a vote on everything and everything should go the way most people want. And there is representative democracy where people elect people and then make decisions, which sometimes is not what a lot of people want. But there is also the libertarian view, which is that the government should just be kept out of a lot of areas completely. So it's not a question of whether it's democratic or not. They just shouldn't be doing anything in those areas. These are all parts of political philosophy and parts of belief systems. So, I don't like governments, but I think that the least evil kind of government under present circumstances is a democracy, a liberal democracy, which is an important qualification because that means that you always preserve the right of minorities to propagandize and maybe eventually become the majority. So you don't prevent minorities from having their say. I could be wrong, and the people who are against democracy could be right. But it is part of a belief system. Athletic teams, that's a very interesting thing. And it's one of the things I have thought about quite a bit, is there does seem to be a sort of bias in whether the rest get it wrong. In other words, it's not evenly divided between the supporters of the two sides. I would put that under my theory that passionate commitment is part of belief systems. I didn't get a chance to develop this because I didn't say everything I wanted to say, but one of the things behind the idea that everybody is irrational is that people get emotional about ideas. And it's true they do, but I maintain that that's right and proper, that they should get emotional about ideas. So an attachment to ideas does not in itself, in my view, amount to irrationality. And you see this in extreme form with football teams. Now, I suppose what I could say is that on the question of Cubs fans, I was once married to a Cubs fan, so I do have some experience in this area. I would say that Cubs fans are entirely rational. I'm not sure if I would say the same about White Sox fans. Yeah, I would. They're all rational. Yeah, they're all rational.
All right. All right, Tim, you had a question.
All right, you have spoken a lot about automatic pilot, people being somewhat rational, but yet I see a lot of irrational behavior, particularly driving in on the Kennedy in the morning. Can you please elaborate why the so-called rational beings make so many irrational decisions when it comes to driving, particularly in rush hour with people being cut off and slamming the brakes too hard and the whole shot, like that?
Well, I mean, the assumption there, I think, I don't know what, you haven't given an example of, well, you have just given an example, but, I mean, I don't think that making a mistake is being irrational. I think that irrational is stronger than that. In fact, only a rational being can make mistakes. I think you can say that it's being able to make mistakes and being rational go together. And if we're ever contacted by some aliens from the other side of the galaxy, if they're rational, which presumably they will be if they can build spaceships and things, we will find that they make mistakes. And we just have to hope that we're not one of their mistakes. people make mistakes all the time.
Okay, Charlie, did you have a question?
Yeah, David, you were asserting there that people join organizations for 2 or 3 years, but I don't think people change. I mean, people who see me 2 or 3 years from now, I get to essentially recognize me and say, whoa, I didn't know that guy at all. Who is that person? I mean, there's consistency in a core, so whether or not their affiliations with some organization doesn't establish that they've changed. I mean, this guy is the same guy I've known, unfortunately, for a long time.
No personal attacks, Charlie.
I mean, People don't change.
Okay,
I mean,
maybe you misunderstood what I was driving at. I mean, it wasn't my view that people's personalities don't maintain a certain continuity. I wasn't trying to argue that at all. My argument was that this is part of an argument that the grip that belief systems have on people is a lot less powerful than you might think it would be if you just look at a snapshot at one particular time. That's all. So one of the arguments for irrationality of human beings is that ideas infect them like viruses, take them over and control them. They're possessed by these ideas, and they're powerless to resist. And I think that's wrong. I think, you know, that you see that people join cults, movements, organizations with belief system goals, and most people who do that leave pretty quickly. Now, I'm not drawing any very profound conclusions from that. What I'm saying is that if you look at an organization, you think, oh, it's a powerful organization. You might be afraid of it, or you might think, that's impressive, I want to join it. Either way, you think it's a really powerful organization, like James Burnham and Whitaker Chambers did in the 1940s with respect to communism. They greatly exaggerated the power of communism. And that's because they were just looking at the way it seemed to them at a particular point in time. Instead of looking at the life cycle, there's a cycle of zeal in people's commitment. That's the point I was making.
Right. Dave, did you have a question?
Yes. It would seem to me that that which is not rational would be something that would not stand up against rationality. So on that basis, I would have to say that people who are members of, let's say, Flat Earth Society and believe the Earth is really flat in spite of everything, or people who believe in communism, that this would not stand up to rationality, and therefore they're not rational. That's one question. Another question is, isn't it fun and pleasurable to do something every once in a while that is irrational?
If you do it because it's fun to do it once in a while, that seems like an impeccably rational motive to do it. But I mean, going back to this, the Flat Earth Society and communism, if we'd been having this discussion in 1935, then you might well find a communist saying that defense of capitalism was like the Flat Earth Society. So one's perception of just how untenable various belief systems are changes. What people think is obvious today is not what they thought was obvious 10 years ago or 20 years ago, and especially not 50 years ago. That's one point I would make. But I would say that I've never met a member of the Flat Earth Society, come to think of it, which is probably a fault of my part, because I'm interested in belief systems, and I really ought to add that to my bag. I've met many communists, and I used to be a kind of communist myself, although I'm not a member of the Communist Party, because I didn't agree with Soviet Russia. But I would say that that people make mistakes, but that doesn't mean they're irrational. I mean, I made a mistake when I thought that socialism would be a more efficient form of organizing production than capitalism. That was a mistake on my part. I had reasons for making that mistake. It was the way the world seemed to me at the time. I thought that was true. And then I came to question it, and eventually I turned against it, and I now take the other view.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
I didn't mean someone who believes in those things. I meant the concept itself.
Well, but the point is the concept has flaws in it, right? That's what you're saying.
Yeah.
The concept itself, there are mistakes in the theory. Presumably, someone who adheres to that theory doesn't see those mistakes. Which I agree with.
Yeah, okay. I'd like to ask a little follow-up question to what Dave just said here, and because you were referring to you were talking about the about it not being irrational to do something because it's fun. So what you're saying is that doing something because it's fun, because it gives you pleasure, is a rational reason to do something. Or if I may elaborate, that, for example, smoking cigarettes, marijuana, angel dust, crack, or opium would be a rational choice to make because every one of those things will give you pleasure.
Well, look. The quick answer is yes, but let's look at this. I mean, you might like the sensation of smoking cigarettes. You might enjoy smoking cigarettes. You might think that increases my chance of dying of lung cancer and having a painful death 10 years earlier than it would otherwise be, and also it's harder to taste things, and so on and so forth. So you can make a list of things that are costs of smoking. Now, I certainly believe this, that you can quite rationally decide that it's worth the risk and keep smoking, just as you can quite rationally decide that you like bungee jumping and it's worth the risk of getting concussion or breaking your neck. That rationality does not prescribe the right way to live for everybody.
All right. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah.
I interrupted
yeah.
you.
I mean, so yeah. I mean, in principle, yeah. But also bear in mind the other point I'm making.
I'm sorry. Start over.
Okay. I got that.
Okay. Start over. I didn't get that first part.
Okay.
One more time, please.
All right. When I say that everybody's rational, I mean four things. One, if we know someone's beliefs and desires, we can understand why they behave as they do. Number two, people seek truth, and this means that they apply logic and look for facts. Number three, verisimilitude is an advantage in the competition of ideas. And verisimilitude means appearing to be true. Number four, people respond to incentives. So those are, when I say that everybody's rational, what I mean is that everybody, every human being who isn't in a coma or otherwise incapacitated, conforms to those four things. And that's what I mean when I say that everyone's rational.
Right, Jeff, you have a question.
Okay, yes, I want to follow up this very thread, actually. Leaving aside, David, good stuff here. Leaving aside the definitions of rationality you have just presented, to what extent do these books that you're critiquing operate off of any sort of coherent, limited concept of rationality, as opposed to just tossing this loaded words like rationality and irrationality around so as to make people seem irrational? To what extent do the books do justice to an effort to engage in rigor with respect to the definition that they're playing around with?
Well, my view is that, and of course, rational is a word, and a word is a social product, and it evolves. And I can't lay down the law about how people should use the word rational. And I think that people often use the word rational where it would be more traditional and more helpful if they used a word like wise or sensible. That's what they really mean, but it sounds more scientific to say rational. And I think that what a lot of these books do is they think that an error is a sign of irrationality, whereas I think an error is a sign of being rational. Only a rational entity can commit errors.
Uh-huh.
right. Now, Dan, I apologize for not getting to you before Jeff. You got a question?
It's okay. I have a question. Quick question.
Sure.
Art, music, literature, is there rational? Does that come from a rational place or an irrational place in the human?
A rational place, of course. But I'm just trying to think how I would best explain that.
Creativity is I guess it's rational. I mean, it's like anything else. It's like algebra or chess or economic system. I mean, it's just another part of study.
I think. Let me say this. I do think that inspiration and creativity and making works of art is entirely rational. I'm trying to think why someone might want to deny that. And I do think there are things that are non-rational but not irrational. For example, if you're a young child who knows nothing about anatomy, let's say, your heart is beating, but you don't know what a heart is. Well, that's not rational because your decision, your deliberate actions don't have anything to do with it, right? It's just a background fact about your body. So there are things going on in the human person which are not irrational, but they're neither rational nor irrational. Rationality just doesn't apply to them. Right, so I would say that could arguably be true in certain types of artistic creation, that there could be things that are generated by randomness or by some kind of selection process that is not rational, but is not irrational either.
Okay, Bob, did you have a question?
Yeah. I was wondering how you accommodate in your theory the strength of the emotions and the will and desires. They're very, very strong, very powerful, very real, very intense. We really feel them. Whereas reason, for most people, is cold, dry, dead, non-exciting, boring, stuff like that. It's like your countryman said, David Hume, he said, reason is and always will be the slave of the passions. Reason is. But because the emotions and will and desire are so strong, felt deeply in us, powerfully, doesn't that make us irrational? Okay.
Yes. Well, David Hume actually and I were both born in the Scottish Lowlands, although I was raised in England, so I don't talk the way David Hume did. So he's my countryman in several senses. I agree entirely with David Hume's statement that reason must always be the slave of the passions. And the way I interpret that statement, and I think this is probably correct, is that logical analysis can't tell you what your goals should be. And so this is what David Hume meant. He meant that you have urges, which you're confronted with, they exist, and you have reason, which he was looking at rather narrowly to mean logic, and reason will help you to achieve your goals as efficiently as possible, and as also achieve one goal without too much endangering another goal. And there is nothing else except the passions that can do that. This is very important point. There is nothing else but the passions that can do that. If somebody says life isn't worth living, and I'm going to cut my throat,
then I would say that on a practical level, you wouldn't take much notice of that. You'd try and cheer them up and hope that they would feel different tomorrow. But on an intellectual level, there is nothing you can say to dissuade them, right? Because that's the way their passions are at that moment, and passions are the final arbiter of anything we ought to do. So I think Hume's absolutely right.
All right, I see a couple of... Ilana, you had a question.
I would like to ask a question. I am from Europe.
So am I. I'm from England. Well, England is sometimes considered bad.
My question to you, how you find that people in England are being rational, like including in European country, like more rational than in this country, or is it kind of dependent from individuality, or are they more rational in England, in Europe, in comparison to this country?
Which is it?
Thank
guilty?
You.
Okay, I mean, I think the human beings everywhere are entirely rational.
Just get it.
It doesn't mean from the lifestyle.
Okay.
Like, well, people more relaxed.
Okay, perfecto. Thank you.
I don't know. I mean, look, I think the people in every country are entirely rational. Now, I mean, there are differences.
I know some people from Ethiopia here.
Well, I think that people in different cultures have different habits and different traditional ways of looking at the world. And it could be, I'm not saying it is in any particular case, but it could be that some of these are better than others by some objective standard.
What ethnic group is the most irrational?
The most irrational? I don't think any ethnic group is irrational.
Okay, all right.
The most rational.
Okay, wait. One for now. If you have a question, raise your hand. Now, Janet had her hand up for a while. Let's go to Janet.
Yeah, okay, you're saying everything is rational. What is irrational? What's an example of something that's irrational thinking, or people that are irrational?
Come in here.
Well, yeah. I don't see any examples in the real world. And I think that whenever you look closely at the cases that people put forward as being irrational, I think you find that they're not quite the way they are made to appear. And let me give a couple of examples of that. One of them would be studies of addiction. You can take the worst kind of alcoholics, or I would say drunks, that are in treatment in some institution. And you can give them a system of rewards and punishments based on how much alcohol they consume. They always respond to these incentives. If the incentive is to drink less alcohol, they drink less alcohol. So this contradicts the popular picture that some people have lost all control over substance addiction. What is true is that some people have made a choice that they're not going to care about some of the consequences of their actions. That may be a mistaken choice, or it may be not a mistaken choice, but either way, it's a rational choice. The other example I would have, rather similar, is people who are in institutions because of what is considered profound and incurable psychosis. And these people too, whether it's schizophrenia or what's all the rage, bipolar, these people too respond to incentives. If you create a structure in the institution where they're rewarded for certain types of behavior, punished by comparatively speaking not having so well when they perform other kinds of behavior, their behavior changes. In other words, they respond to incentives. So I think that it's a myth. It's like demon possession, irrational possession. It's a myth. There is no demon possession. There are no demons, and there is no possession by irrationality. It's a myth.
All right, Rhonda, did you have a question?
No.
Okay. All right. Now, is there anybody who has a question who has not already asked a question? No? Well, Dave, you had your hand up. Go ahead.
What about people who really are nuts? Aren't they the nuts? Shall we say, don't respond to incentives. People in insane asylums or whatever.
That's what I'm saying.
Who don't know right from wrong, who are completely bonkers. Aren't they irrational?
I think that people's picture of those people is mistaken. I think that you find that they do respond to incentives. Now, of course, there are people who have brain damage or otherwise so below a certain level in cognitive functioning that they don't understand anything that's going on around them. They might as well be in a coma, or they are in a coma. And I fully accept that you're dealing, a corpse is neither rational nor irrational. A person in a coma is neither rational nor irrational. Whether people can be active and walk around and that can be true of them is, that's a controversial matter for empirical research. But in principle, there could be people who, and they're not really people, right, because they're so out of it. But someone who's deluded and thinks that they're Napoleon, they're perfectly rational.
Okay, but what about, Mr. Steele, what about a person who suffers from Alzheimer's disease or some other form of dementia? Would you argue that this person is still rational?
Yes, of course. I mean, what's happening is that things are failing. My memory sometimes fails, but their memory fails. Maybe in 10 years' time, if I've got Alzheimer's, my memory will fail even more frequently. So it's tragic when somebody doesn't recognize someone they've known all their life, or something like that. The question is, do they ever adjust their actions to achieve a goal in an appropriate way so that they achieve the goal, make it more likely they'll achieve the goal? Most people with Alzheimer's, I think they do. They may reach a certain point where they don't, in which case you say they're no longer either rational or irrational. They might as well be in a coma. But to me, the idea that they're irrational, there is the proverbial expression, I may be crazy, but I'm not stupid. Well, I think a lot of people are stupid, but not crazy. I think it's the other way around. And, I think that people's IQ may fall, and their ability to process information, their memory and all the rest of it may decline, and they may reach a point where they can't do anything. But in as much as people perform deliberate actions at all, I think that they are rational.
All right, Tim, did you have a question?
Just one. Define madness.
Well, in psychiatric terminology, madness is usually acquainted with psychosis. And psychosis is usually considered more severe than neurosis. Thomas Zars, who is a person I have some admiration for, who was a psychiatrist and became a critic of psychiatry, once said that a neurotic is someone who upsets himself, and a psychotic is someone who upsets other people.
Okay.
Good one. Charlie, do you have a question?
Yeah, David, you began by saying people will embrace what I would call a package belief system or an entire cosmology for a relatively brief period of time. But is that the same as all the other beliefs that are, let's say, more itemized or ephemeral, such as global warming? Is not, it could be, I guess, but it's certainly not the cosmology of an organized religion.
Well, okay, there are different types.
I hear a zillion things here that don't achieve
you
the
all
magnitude
sorts
of
things,
religion,
right?
You know, I mean,
Well, look, I think that global warming is a typical enthusiastic ideology, like communism, or like psychoanalysis, or like various other... Now, that doesn't mean it's wrong, right? That's a separate question. But the people who believe in global warming are committed to it with a ferocity that, just like that of a communist committed to communism in the 1930s, just like an Islamic terrorist committed to a particular version of course, most Islamic people are not terrorists, but and don't support terrorism, but someone who is committed to a particular sect of Islam and that endorses terrorism is committed to that, and global warming is no different. And opposition to global warming from people like me, the skeptical movement, is no different. It's also an enthusiastic ideological movement. So there are these enthusiastic ideological movements. That is not to say that anything they say is wrong. That's a separate question. You know, Ayn Rand's objectivism, I think, is very clear, a cult. Now, there are lots of things Ayn Rand said that I think are quite right. Usually the things that are least original are actually, come to think of it. But, there are certain... the fact that global warming doesn't have a particular story of the creation of the universe or what happens to us after death, I don't think that's all that important. That's also true of many other belief systems, like EST or psychoanalysis. They're not committed to, but they are enthusiastic belief systems. So the missionaries of global warming, are just like members of a religious group. I recently had the supreme hilarious joy of reading AR5. If you follow these matters, you know what that means. It's the fifth assessment report of the IPCC, which is the High Church of Global Warming.
What does IPCC stand for?
Intergovernmental something 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 climate change.
Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change.
Yeah, it's a UN. It's a UN organization. So it gets tax funded. It gets trillions of tax money from every country in the world. Right. Now, it's a hilarious document if you've got the right kind of sense of humor. And it's partly the religiosity of it that is so hilarious. So I do think global warming, but I don't accept my own beliefs. I'm a libertarian. I think that libertarianism is an enthusiastic ideology. And to say that is not to say that anything that is right or wrong in the content of that ideology.
Okay, and we're actually running out of time here, folks.
We have to go to rebuttals.
We're gonna have to stop it. We're going to have to stop the question. I actually had another question, but we're going to have to stop the questions even from me and go straight into rebuttals.
All right.
So, first of all, okay, let's have
thank our speaker.
All right. Would you mind sitting over to the right, please? Okay, now, listen, would you mind taking this briefcase?
I wouldn't mind that either.
Okay, thank you. All right.
Now, let's get started.
All right, now what? Right, let's get into the rebuttal period. All right, now, on deck,
reply to all these.
Okay, now, attention. These are the on deck chairs. Okay, this one. Here, you first, Jeff. Okay, now, all right. Now, if you got something
He's
to say,
staying.
come here. No. It's musical chairs. Attention.
Yeah, I know.
Attention. It's musical chairs from here over to here.
We got
some dessert.
Okay. All right. Now.
We figured
okay.
It out.
All right. Wrong way. Dave, other direction. This way. Go this direction. Go this direction.
Get to those chairs.
Yeah, it's too hard to get through that.
Under the table.
Anyway, you come after Jeff. All right. How many? All right. Now. Now, how many want to speak? Raise your hands and keep your hand up. Okay. One, two, three. Hands up, folks. Four, five, six, seven, eight. All right. Nine, and counting the. Okay. I'm going to count. Okay. Nine, including the speaker. Okay. 5 minutes each, y'all.
All right, let's go.
Okay.
Thanks to speaker, by the way.
Yay. Thank you, Jeff.
All right. I asked a question pertinent to the loaded nature of the word rational. And what I'm going to try to do for you folks is to lay out a map of at least three different ways we could possibly mean that word. I'm going to distinguish between broad belief systems containing multiple propositions, like religions or political movements, from specific propositions or specific lines of argument. When folks take formal logic, and I'll bet Bob will back me up on this, arguably the very first thing you're taught in many cases is Aristotle's, if I remember right, it was Aristotle's syllogism about Socrates, which goes, if Socrates is a man, and if all men are mortal, therefore Socrates is mortal. All right. Now that, folks, is a logical argument, irrespective of the truth value of each of the two premises. Well, you can assume the truth, and if you assume the truth of each of those two premises, that Socrates is a man, that's an empirical premise, and that all men are mortal is also an empirical premise, you must reach the conclusion that therefore Socrates was mortal.
But I thought it was a quotient
for
integers.
Yeah, one point
at
a time.
Please, I'm trying to... All right. That's one kind of proposition, a logical argument, which in this case happens to consist of all of premises that we all agree are reasonable. Well, what about a possibly logical argument that consists of unreasonable premises? We might have to concede that such an argument is rational in the strictest sense of the word, but nonetheless regard it as unreasonable. Ballpark example. A Nazi might argue that whatever the Führer does is necessary, therefore he has the divine blessing. And this was the kind of arguments that those folks made in Hitler's day. Well, there's the empirical issue of whether everything the Führer did was necessary. That's an empirical question. But insofar as one could, were to decide to buy that empirical claim, which, you know, you in the first instance, let's call an empirical claim, it is not utterly irrational to jump from that empirical proposition to the idea that indeed he had the divine blessing. If some guy goes around doing one necessary thing after another, it's not wildly unreasonable to think, gee, maybe he does have the divine blessing. But you see, folks, that notion, that jump, as it were, from that everything he does is necessary to therefore he has a divine blessing, that is not in and of itself a logical conclusion from the premise, although it might be fairly reasonable. And that's a lot of times in our disputes, when we say colloquially someone is being either reasonable or unreasonable, we're referring to these kind of jumps from a premise to a conclusion where the relationship is not strictly speaking logical, as was in the case of the syllogism that I gave you folks that Aristotle came up with about Socrates' mortality. And so in a lot of cases, and I'll bet this applies to global warming as a particular issue, let alone to a bunch of others, where there's ideologies wrapped up, all sorts of propositions wrapped up in packages, you've got a situation where a judgment is made rather than where we can definitively say either Socrates is mortal or he's not. So that's one point. I want to make another point briefly, and this pertains, David, to your notion of science versus politics. As I understand it, when Einstein's theory was accepted, it was a result of a specific observation with improved telescopes of the direction that the waves of the sun came out, that he predicted that no one else predicted. So that was not an arbitrary thing. There was a specific empirical piece of evidence that came out that changed the equation in favor of his theory. Whereas, again, with so many of these other kind of propositions, non-scientific propositions, there's all sorts of evidence which may not be decisively relevant, which may be marginally relevant, or a tad more than marginally relevant. So there's going to be all sorts of gradations in our debates as to whether a piece of evidence in and of itself ought to be decisive, as opposed to merely of relevance of undetermined and perhaps undeterminable weight. So, is that it? No, I don't hear
it. Yeah, actually, yeah. Mm-hmm. Spent 5 minutes already.
Okay.
Sorry. Good evening. I think that it was Einstein who said that irrationality is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. I agree with many of the things that David Steele said this evening. And I think it's always very, very nice to have a fellow libertarian.
Can't hear you. There you go.
It's always very nice to have a fellow libertarian present. And he quoted Ayn Rand and mentioned something about her book, Objectivism. I read it and I thought it was pretty appropriate. I think that if you have a system like communism and it has been shown not to work and it's failed time after time where it was put into practice, that system can pretty well be said to be irrational and that would be correct. However, that doesn't mean that people that might accept that are irrational. It merely means they're mistaken, or they have other reasons for doing it, perhaps finding positions of power within the party or something like that. But the concept itself would be irrational. And Ayn Rand pointed out that the best way to fight communism, which is irrationality, is with rationality, and that rationality extinguishes all these things, because in the end, rationality must stand up to criticism, and things like communism will not. So I disagree with our speaker that he seems to be saying that there's no such thing as irrationality, but there is irrationality. And so these concepts like communism or certain other ones are irrational concepts. Therefore, there is such a thing in this world as irrationality. Thank you. That's all I've got to say.
Fix that microphone.
Oh. Yeah. Oops. I mean, just speak up. Scout. Try and speak up louder. I'll just try and talk a little more loudly. I don't really have a lot to say, which is unusual. But what I did want to say is this evening for me, our speaker's presentation was one of the best I've heard in quite a while here. It had some of the best and intellectual content, and for me, gave me a new way of looking at some things that I haven't had before. And so I very, very much enjoyed the presentation tonight. I have to say I disagree with the speaker on one thing. I don't think that we can in any way say that Cubs fans are rational, even though I'm a Cubs fan some of the time. and I want to actually take issue with Dave here a little bit, and he's saying that communism is irrational. Well, no, that depends on what your goals are. If your goals are to create the most total wealth, communism does not do that. We've seen that time and again. But if your goal is to create the most equal distribution of what goods and services are produced, then communism is very rational, because communism will do that. So I think our speaker covered that in saying if we know what people's desires are and beliefs, then we can understand why they act the way they do. Thank you.
Okay.
Is there no microphone or
what? I don't know, Brian. Does this
project
need a battery or what?
Project.
But it's not working.
I mean, it's echoing, but...
Just go ahead and speak loudly.
We had one and then
it didn't seem to work when I was talking at it.
Yeah.
Even though
no, it wasn't working.
It wasn't
working. It was kind of an adjustment. Excuse me.
Okay, it doesn't
work.
Wait. One at a time. Look, okay. One at a time. It wasn't working when Dave was still... I'm sorry, Rhonda. It isn't working, so I guess y'all have to try to get along.
Okay.
How about starting your clock now?
Okay, I agree. Yeah, we'll start the clock now.
Okay. Well, I hope that I don't have that much to say, but I'm a little scattered here tonight with this. I should say first, David, I disagree with your use of the word neurotic and the use of the word psychotic, because it's my understanding that those are outdated terms. I'm sure they're still used in layman's terms, but I was told that in the psychiatric community, in terms of diagnosing people, that's no longer, I was told that 20 or 30 years ago, that's no longer in use. So that's just a side point. So I got a little frustrated, and I looked up what rationality is on my handy-dandy phone, and I got a lot of different information. In Wikipedia, I got... the first thing I got was rationality is the state of being agreeable to reason. And actually the Wikipedia was interesting because then it goes on to talk about how the term rationality is used in different ways, in different ideological systems. So I basically completely ignored that because I thought that would be just as intensely filled with lots of philosophical points as David's discussion is. I hope you don't mind my calling you by your first name. No. And but then I looked at Merriam-Webster, and they gave me the exact same definition for their first definition, and their second definition, they also put reasonableness. So then I looked up reason, and reason or reasoning is associated with thinking, cognition, and intellect. And reason, like habit or intuition, is one of the ways by which thinking comes from one idea to a related idea. For example, it is the means by which rational beings, understand themselves to think about cause and effect, truth and falsehood, and what is good or bad. And it goes on a little bit. But I do want to say, therefore, there's more. But I think that if you look at human beings and say, what causes their behavior, you can say there's always some rationality for it. But if you're actually saying, is a person rational or not, you gave the example of this experiment that was done with the lines. Well, you can say that rationality should be following the logic that if this line is a certain length, the person's telling you what the length is, but they should always be telling you that. That's what you assume their rationality should be. If you say, then they change it because it's more important in terms of the overall welfare of a person to conform to society sometimes, then, you know, their still being a rational being, but it's a different argument. It's a different focus of what is rational or not. So I think that part of what happens is that people, when you say that people like to think that everyone's irrational, a lot of people have a lot of competing ways of making decisions. And so, for instance, and a lot of people have a lot of competing views about why they do things. So if I said to you, whenever I go grocery shopping, I always go a certain way. I always go around the store like this, and then I do this. I go through this aisle and that aisle. And then you said to me, well, wait a second, what about that time yesterday? You what did you do? I said, oh, I just went and picked up a bottle of milk. I didn't go around the store. Now, why is that? Is that because I was lying in the first place, or is it maybe because I don't think of that as grocery shopping? I was thinking of, when I made the first statement, I made a statement about when I do a full grocery shopping. I didn't. So semantics, I think, sometimes plays a role in how we think about things and whether we're rational or not. You could. Here's another example. Is that whenever I take the bus to the Hillside restaurant. Well, if you say, whenever I go to the Hilltop restaurant, that's where we are. Whenever I go to the Hilltop restaurant, I always go north and then west. I never go west and then north to get here. And then the person says, well, what about when that person gave you a ride? Oh, I only meant whenever I take the bus.
Okay. Hey, Bob, did you want to speak?
Yeah.
You can let Brown go first.
Yeah,
okay. I just don't get up and pass.
All right.
Right.
Yeah. David Ramsay, you have given us
some ice tea?
Some picture of rationality, but the question is how of whether one is being rational or consistent in some way is whether one's ultimate imperatives are related effectively to our immediate decisions. And our wishes are not fulfilled always by our actions, there's an open question as to how rational our behavior is. One can question a belief system as its rationality or its accuracy if the objective is clearly known and the behavior is inconsistent with it. So you can question the rationality of Jesus who sacrifices himself for the good of others when he realizes and acts in a fashion that results in his death and the deaths of many of his disciples and his friends. But he's trying to be consistent with the love that he has for humanity generally, for being human, we realize and can identify, or many Christians do, identify with the his willingness to give up his life and to ask others to give their lives as well.
That's irrational.
Okay. The question of the rationality of belief systems is an open one, of course. How much time do I have left?
Well, you got about 30 seconds.
Having been a very active socialist, I'm not a Trotskyist, but a democratic socialist, and influenced by Trotskyists. I am glad that I am not entirely consistent with general Trotskyist line. Anyway, that's my observation.
Well, we got many interesting and correct ideas tonight about humans' hunger for the truth. They do. They don't often get it. And we have a rapid turnover in our beliefs. And all religions of the world were spread by political force, all of them. That's why they became popular. And they're all cults. But if they get politics behind them, they become a world religion. If they get the sword behind them, like in Islam, and then they spread. And Christianity is pretty good. Good treat some Native Americans. South America, Central America, engaging in genocide if they didn't convert. In many places, not everywhere. Suicide terrorists are rational. They are rational. sort of camel targets. Okay, a lot of good points. Interesting points, but the thesis is wrong. People are deeply irrational. Plato depicted the human soul, or mind, to be three parts. Two parts were emotion and desire, and those were by far the biggest parts, the desire. Emotions were really big for Plato. Although he called them appetites back then, we would call them emotions today. That's in his Republic. The busy council, the just individual, or a good individual. In his dialogue with Phaedrus, he depicted the human soul as a chariot, and as a driver, you and I, and we have to control two steeds, one's noble, one's ignoble. The noble steed is reason, but the ignoble steed is desire and emotions, and the ignoble steed always drags us down to earth, and we rarely get up to heaven. Very few people make it to the realm of ideas, except for the College of Complexes, and we're a tiny minority of people interested in ideas. But thank God there is a group like this in Chicago. There's none in New York, I betcha. Except a bunch of academics, and you know, they're just trying to promote themselves. Nobody can understand what the hell they're saying anyway. But what is reason? Reason I would define as using reasons. You know, it's not logic, and Hume has got a very narrow concept of logic, as David pointed out. There were a narrow concept of reason as logic. Logic is only sound thinking, good thinking. That can only that's only our means to our ends. It's not the end. The ends are often irrational. They're often just something we want, something we desire, and something we choose. But you got to start somewhere, and it's probably not rational. Hopefully, it is. Yeah, metaphysically we're quite irrational. Our biggest parts are emotional and volitional, our will and desire for our point of view, political or religious. Those are pretty irrationally chosen. Hopefully we can make them rational. But we're often overwhelmed, like Plato said, by emotions and reason, emotion and will. But we ought to be rational. As Plato said, it's our only way of knowing the truth. The only way. It's a weak, feeble candle in a dark, endless sea of emotion and reason. Woe to anyone who puts it out. Woe to anyone who puts it out. But we're very irrational. I wish we weren't, but we are, basically. We ought to be rational.
What? You think me mad? Wait until you see how carefully and how scientifically I put together these ideas of rationality and irrationality.
Tar, okay?
This idea all of a sudden came to me and consumed me beyond reasonable expectations. What am I saying that idea is? Well, I'll tell you what that idea is. Imagine if you had the whole source of power in your whole life inclined in this thing like this, in a bonfire like this. What if I said I had a conclusion to global warming? You would tell me either fantastic or preposterous, either rational or irrational. But I say, our guy held this up. I say, I hold this up, which is the solution to our problems.
What's that? Wait, let's see it again.
It's called thorium-232. The liquid fluoride thorium reactor.
What's that 233?
It's 233, which is the, okay. I meant to say uranium-233. Like I said, a little irrational, but not mad. My ideas are fantastical, preposterous. Many of you think that socialism will be the way to go forward. Well, I tell you, with the economic theory of rational man, fantastic or preposterous, to you socialists out there, I tell all of you, you're not irrational. You're absolutely preposterous. Much different than irrationality. I think perhaps we should have a new definition. Not so much irrationality, but preposterous. And frankly, tonight, we've had a good definition of rational thinking. But rationality can lead to preposterous isms. Oh, fantastic ideas. So what? You think I'm mad?
Yes.
That's your opinion. I say sometimes maybe a little preposterous, but utterly fantastic, Mr. Speaker.
All right. When you say preposterous, is that below your posture?
Okay, preposterous. Okay, did you want to talk, Charlie?
You go ahead if you want.
Oh, no, you're not ready? Okay.
Yeah, I'll tell you.
Okay, all right. Well, anybody else want to talk? Nope, we got time. All right, I'm going to go up and speak. Okay. There's no microphone here, I just realized. Okay. All right, now, I'd just like to, first of all, very briefly, I need somebody to time me. Tim. Would you be willing to time me? Give me 5 minutes.
Yes.
Okay. You just can count from now.
Okay.
All right. First of all, I'd just like to review our speaker's definition of rationality. Which, first of all, I wrote it down. If we know someone's, I'm paraphrasing a little bit here, but if we know someone's beliefs and desires, we can understand the reasons for doing things. Second, that people seek truth by applying logic and facts. And third, that verisimilitude, or as Stephen Colbert would call it, truthiness, is an advantage in the marketplace of ideas. And fourth, that people respond to incentives. Now,
I thought, first of all, I wanted to say that this, I thought this was a really interesting lecture tonight. I think we had a good speaker, and I enjoyed this. It's very thought-provoking. It's provocative of rational thought, I should hope. But in any event, I would have to say that our speaker's definition of rationality and of rational behavior was so broad that all human behavior would count as rational, no matter what. And now in logic, this is called victory by definition. This is where you redefine a word so as to achieve the desired result. So, for example, let's say, to go back to communism, supposing I'm a committed communist and I go and I argue. Communism cannot help but work. And then some naysayer comes up and says, hey, what about Russia? That turned out to be a big mess. What about that? Well, that's not real communism. And then somebody says, well, what about China? Now they're turning to market reforms. What about that? And I said, oh, well, they never really had communism either. See? So I've achieved victory by definition. I define communism my way so that I can still argue that communism cannot help but work. And I see the same thing going on here with rational thinking. I dare say that most people would say that if you are shooting yourself up with heroin just because it makes you feel good and you can't stop, that's, no matter what it does to your health or your pocketbook, that's not rational behavior. Okay? I don't know too many people who would say that it is. Now, there's a question which did not get answered tonight, which I wanted to answer, which is rational thought innate, or must it be learned? I can tell you this. Logic, as formulated by Aristotle, is definitely not innate. It has to be learned. And I would go further and say that I think human beings are capable of rational thinking, but that it is something that we have to learn how to do. We're not born with that knowledge. It's not, and we certainly aren't born, with the ability to think logically and make, and as for making an intelligent decision, you would have to have perfect knowledge to be able to do that, and nobody has total knowledge of everything. Now, do people make decisions based on what is in their own rational self-interest, or if self-interest is not your primary goal, do people make decisions based on some kind of rational consideration?
Well,
people may, in the short run, make decisions based on reason, but the goals, in the long run, are often not rational. The goals are not so much rational as emotional. And this is to go back to what David Hume said about reason being the slave of the passions. Yeah, I think advertisers, marketers understand this, and this is why when they design an effective advertising campaign, they try to appeal much more to the emotions than to reason. The same is true with political campaigns. A successful political campaign appeals at least as much to emotions as it does to reason. As a matter of fact, I think our speaker understands this, because when he was talking about global warming, tonight, he used what I would call loaded language. He referred to, first of all, that he calls the global warming, the belief in global warming, as if equivalent to, let's say, the belief in God or the belief in Santa Claus. Okay, so it's something that one may believe or not, your choice. Second, what if I talked about the belief that the Earth was round, or the belief that the Earth revolves around the Sun instead of vice versa? He also referred to the people who want to do something about global warming as an enthusiastic ideology. So you see how that's kind of loaded language too. We call communism an ideology. And I see that Tim is drawing his finger across his throat, which implies that I may get my throat cut if I don't quit pretty soon.
No, you got about maybe 15 seconds.
15 seconds. All right. Well, I would just want to say that this is emotional language. I would also want to say that our speaker, fortunately, I know you mentioned that you're a libertarian. I believe that it's essential to libertarianism to believe, number one, that human beings are rational, and number two, that there's no such thing as global warming. Otherwise, libertarianism falls to the ground.
Okay. All right, Charlie.
All right.
5 minutes.
5 minutes, I don't have that much time. All right, thank you very much, sir, for returning with a nice presentation there. Let me remind you, we are the playground for people who think. I sometimes forget that. Let's see. I think, sir, you have to differentiate between, sir already indicated this, between a all-encompassing package belief system and these organizations or affiliations or opinions, if you wish, which are with sundry opinions and things like that. Also, there's a distinction, I don't want to get into it, I think that you were, there's a distinction between the autonomic and sympathetic nervous systems. Sympathetic is the one we control. I think you were talking about that. But I'd like to focus here on whether or not which is preferable, individual actions or collective actions, and which will bring us the best end result. And a rational person can choose. Now, you can go to the boss and you can make your demands on the conditions of employment. And you may or may not get what you want. People do this on very often. They go in to see the boss and they think the boss immediately is going to take their side and grant them their wish. I kind of inclined to think that collectively, if you present your demands to the boss, the situation changes. It's called collective bargaining. And I think he's going to have to regard the collective body of employees infinitely differently than he would the individual. It's, as a matter of fact, on a utilitarian, rational basis, been proven to work, far more so than any other system. Now, a rational person would say, well, if you would choose, what is the most effective, pragmatic method for achieving what you want, which is an improvement in the conditions of employment? So therefore, it's totally irrational to be libertarian and completely rational to be a communist if you want to improve your station in life. It's irrefutable. The other thing is, looking this week, whether or not this individual thing, I was looking today, they came out with the figures this week of how people have fared acting individually in a free market capitalist system. And the income under during the period of the recovery, beginning, what was it, 2009, the 1% have increased in wealth by 31%. The 99% of us have increased in wealth 0.4%. Now, a rational person would say that free market capitalism isn't very good because you're getting nothing. And while it doesn't mean that you're getting a small slice of the pie, you're getting almost virtually no pie, where a guy's keeping the pie for himself. And yet, I don't know, I guess there's some rational reason for being a libertarian in the light of this data, which is irrefutable and mathematical. And I give you a solution on this, but nevertheless, interesting thing. And the other thing I wanted to talk about that I came across was this is the greatest thing of the rational of the free market capitalism. And I was thinking about it during the week because these people were clamoring for wanting what they want is a living wage. And the free market capitalist was saying, oh no, blah, 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 we can't do this. Now, it's a rational person would say you cannot have an employee and expect them to work X number of hours per week unless they're able to live. And these people were asking for a living wage. Now, they actually are arguing against this and fighting against it. How do you have employees if they don't have enough to live? You can't have employees unless they're alive. There's no other rational way to do this. Now, if you want employees, they have to be able to live. And to say that there are compelling arguments against this, I don't know. But anyhow, thank you. You gave us a lot to kick around here.
Okay.
And I'll plunk the course here.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Speaker gets the last word.
How much time do I have?
Take as long as you want.
It's 9 o'clock, but try to keep within 5-10 minutes.
I'll try.
Okay, it's 9 o'clock.
And if I'm rational, I should succeed. I'll just pick up a few of these points at random as the ones I think I've got something to say about. In the example that was given about the Fuhrer and the divine blessing, the second example was just as valid as the first example, except that you didn't mention one of the premises. And the premise you didn't mention was, if anyone's actions are necessary, then he has the divine blessing. That would make it a syllogism, with the major premise, a minor premise, and a valid conclusion. On the question of communism containing irrationality, I think this is wrong. I think that communism as a doctrine is entirely rational. Now, I think there are mistakes in communism. You'd see, my whole argument is to distinguish between mistakes and irrationality. A mistake is a mistake, and can be corrected. Now, I think there are mistakes in the doctrine of communism. I could give you some examples. The theory of surplus value that Marx put forward, the materialist conception of history, which I think has got a rough approximation to the truth, but is, on the whole, not true. And then, if you want to develop, Lenin's theory of imperialism, I think, is a disastrous blunder. It wasn't true at all. And then, of course, the whole assumption that a socialist economy would be more productive than a capitalist economy. That wasn't true. Those were mistakes that were made. Understandable mistakes, given the background of ideas and everything. But it's rational. It makes sense. You can see where the mistakes are, and you can point them out, and you can show someone that this is not going to work.
Would it work for the 99%?
Well, the 99% in Soviet Russia were not better off than in the West. I mean, by the way, somebody said that communism does give you equal shares, but it doesn't produce more wealth. Well, first of all, the promise of communism was that it would produce more wealth. That was the argument. In fact, the main argument of Marx was the materialist conception of history, that a form of society that can develop the productive forces to produce more wealth will supplant a form of society that is less good at producing wealth in that sense. So productivity of labor should be higher in a socialist system than in a communist system. And I think most people now recognize that that's just not true.
Yes,
capitalism
slaves
is necessary for
harder.
The maximum productivity.
People enslaved were harder.
So, but I mean, the whole story of communism versus capitalism, there were experiments were thrown up by history. West Germany and East Germany, North Korea and South Korea, Hong Kong and Taiwan and mainland China. And
Russia
you saw
under the Tsar.
You saw misery on one side and rapid growth of wealth on the other side. In the case of Hong Kong, from a very, very low starting point, everybody was close to starvation at one point. But then 30 years later, the average income in Hong Kong was vastly greater than the average income in the People's Republic of China. And of course, the average income in Japan and Taiwan and South Korea, there's South Korea and North Korea as an example. East Germany and West Germany. These are experiments. And every time you get an experiment like that, it always turns out that substantially private, substantially free market capitalism is better for the 99% than a state-controlled system.
Yes.
So
tell it to the waitress. At 2.13 cents.
Let me say something about logic. I mean, strictly speaking, logic is the formalization of inference, but we use it now to mean inference. Now, people use inference all the time, and the most inferences that are useful to people are quite simple. If I say that the train leaves the station every day at 6 p.m., therefore it's going to leave the station tomorrow at 6 p.m., that's a logical inference, right? Very simple, blindingly obvious, but it's a logical inference. If I say, in this election, the candidate with the most wins, with the most votes wins, and Jones got twice as many votes as Smith, and they were the only two candidates, it follows that Jones won the election. That's an inference, a logical inference. And we all make, ordinary people, even people who are not very bright, make flawless logical inferences 1,000 times a day of that kind of nature. And another aspect of this is, if you look at the study of logic, you can take a course in logic, and you can study logic for, say, 10 years, intensively for 10 years. But the part of that logic course that is useful for dealing with practical situations in everyday life, you would have completed in the first 3 months. In other words, advanced logic has nothing to tell you that is going to help you at all in ordinary everyday life. It's going to help you if you're doing philosophy of logic. It's going to help if you're going to do philosophy of mathematics. But it's not going to help you spot. It's not going to help you spot fallacies in the arguments of politicians or advertisers. You'll learn all that stuff in the first 3 months. So logic is essentially a very simple thing that people use all the time. Humans use it all the time, and mostly flawlessly. Mostly flawlessly.
Deduction only. Not induction.
Well,
not language. Not fallacies.
There is an argument about whether there is such a thing as inductive logic. But I don't want to get into that. There is a whole question about whether science uses induction. But that would take us to... I'll come and give you a talk on Karl Popper some other time. That would take us too far afield. Trade unions, if the people get together in a workplace, they can sometimes get... make greater progress in getting improvements in conditions than if they're just bargaining individually.
Well, get you a spoon, honey.
It depends partly on the legal environment. If they're allowed to beat up people who want to come in and take the job for a lower wages, for instance, they'll be more successful than if they're not allowed to do that. But still, it's true. On the other hand, every time a trade union in a workplace makes that gain, workers elsewhere get less. They don't magically, you know, the output of that particular industry is shrunk by the fact that the labour costs are higher. So it's not a gain for the working class, it's a gain for the section of the working class in that particular place of employment. Well, I don't know what Charlie was complaining about. He said that the 1% it went up and the 99% it went up. So they both went up. So what's the problem? Everybody gained. But you know, the composition of the 1% changes all the time. 1% of the people with the most savings. That's constantly, people are constantly dying and leaving that, and new people are coming up and replacing them. It's not the same people this year as it was last year.
Oh, that's great to know.
And the minimum wage, if you establish if you enforce a minimum wage, you're going to create unemployment.
Oh, of course.
Because what will happen is, I mean, why don't we have people coming and polishing your windshield in gas stations anymore? Why don't we have people bussing tables in working class diners? It's because the minimum wage has made that impossible. Why don't we have people clearing snow off the sidewalks the way we did in the 1950s and 1960s? Because of the minimum wage. I mean, it's not, if somebody is offering to do a job, willing to do a job, that is only worth a certain small amount, and then you say you're not allowed to do that, you're not allowed to hire them at that low pay, then what's going to happen? Well, I agree, a small section will get a pay increase. But there's a larger section will just not get any work. That's why a raise in the minimum wage is essentially directed against black teenagers. You're essentially passing a law saying it's illegal to hire black teenagers because they're the most unproductive.
I work all week,
they're the most unproductive section of the workforce.
Oh,
and therefore, the people who would get the lowest wage, and you're passing a law that's saying don't hire black teenagers or you'll go to jail. Wonderful. I don't want to get into the global warming debate, but I will make this statement in case there's any misapprehension. That when we talk about global warming and skepticism, we're talking about a whole series of propositions that warming is mainly created by carbon dioxide emissions from human activity and that it's going to lead to catastrophe unless we cut those emissions. There was a period in recent history where there was some slight warming, right? There has been no warming. If you don't know this, you should. There has been no warming for 17 years. Global temperatures have been stationary for 17 years. But prior to that, there was a period where there was a very, very slight increase in global temperatures. When people say they're skeptical about global warming, they're not saying there is never any warming, and neither are they saying no part of that warming is due to human activity. What they're saying is the warming is not dangerous, it's nothing to worry about, it's not going to cause catastrophe. Glaciers are in great shape. The Arctic ice is in great shape. The polar bears are at the maximum population that has ever been
irrational.
Extreme weather events are at the all-time low. Forget all that stuff. Forget the Al Gore stuff. It's for the playground for people who think, not people who don't think.
I think it's completely rational.
Yeah.
Now, there is this...
Before I left and watched the documentary, there's no glaciers in the
Alps. There was this claim that by saying that everybody's rational, this is merely a victory by definition. I don't think that's true. After all, sometimes it's true that you can make a genuine discovery that something applies to everything in a particular class. It's not always, if you want me to explain a counterexample, I would say if suddenly people were seized by an uncontrollable urge to stick pins in their eyeballs, this was just to break out and happen for absolutely no antecedent reason in the lives of these people or their convictions or them, that would be irrational behavior. There's all kinds of behavior I could describe to you that you never see, we never observe, that I would grant you would be irrational behavior. But we don't see it. What we see is people doing things we disapprove of, and people holding opinions we disagree with. That's what we actually observe. And we want to abuse the people who do that by calling them bad names, so we don't just say, you're mistaken for the following reasons, A, B, C, D. We say, you're irrational. We used to say, you're evil, you're possessed by the devil, you're totally depraved. But now we say, you're irrational because it sounds more scientific. But it isn't more scientific, it's just more pretentious. Reason the slave of the passions. The point is this. A logical analysis proceeds from propositions to propositions to propositions. This doesn't tell you what to do. When you decide to do something, you're not describing the world, you're pursuing certain goals. Where do those goals come from? They come from your values. Where do your values come from? I'm afraid they come from your passions. Nowhere else. And you have appetites, you have habits, you have inclinations. So these are the things that you
objectives.
Pursue. You have objectives, right. So reason is the slave of the passions. It's one of the most brilliant insights, actually, in the history of thought.
Yes.
Couldn't be any other way. That's the point. It couldn't be any other way. It's not conceivable that it could be any other way. Now, there are some combinations of passions that, if you try to pursue them all at once, it's going to be disastrous, and you should try and regulate. Now, people who have said you should pursue pleasure and aim in life, like the Epicureans, and other hedonists of various stripes would always say, take a long-term view, balance the probability of this against the probability of that, and don't behave in a short-sighted, short-term way, because that you might wake up a week from now and greatly regret it. So the reason being the slave of the passions is perfectly compatible with a long-term view, and that's Epicureanism. Now, somebody said, well, by calling it a belief in global warming, this, I'm not going to make a point about global warming, just about the logic of the argument. I'm saying it's the same as the belief that the Earth goes around the sun. Well, yeah, it is a belief that the Earth goes around the sun. And it is a, you know, all these things are beliefs. And they're beliefs that one can disagree with or agree with. Some of them look better to me than others. So what? You know, I think the Earth goes around the sun. And I think don't accept that, that we're on the edge of a catastrophic end to the world because of a minuscule increase in carbon dioxide.
Okay.
You got to come to the meeting of the Greens, man.
I thought someone was going to say it's not minuscule. They might have told them the proportions of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere.
Anyway, you're head in the sand or what?
All right, we got to get.
Show all kinds of strange things.
Okay, we got to wrap.
We got to start wrapping up.
So, what I would like to say in conclusion is that the belief that people are irrational leads people to underestimate the power of rational argument. Now, it's true that rational argument is not all-powerful, and it's often swamped by other factors, but it is, does have a positive force. And a good example of this, I think, so happens that I'm very interested in left-wing thought in the 1930s, is the way the left reacted to what they called fascism, which included things that were not fascism, like National Socialism and Spanish Nationalism. They reacted to this in two ways. The left reacted to fascism, what they called fascism, in two ways. First of all, they said that this is a sign of that capitalism is about to collapse. And the only way it can avoid collapse is by big business creating fascism. In order to delude the masses. But now that leaves the question unanswered. Why do the masses follow fascism? What's the appeal of fascism? And so there they said, well, somehow these people like Mussolini and Hitler, they've got hold of some trick to hoodwink the masses, to exert some irrational control over them. And so here you have this combination of circumstances. Big business is paying for these groups, but they have a trick that the left-wingers, who remember are 90% of the intellectuals, that they can't figure out. So there's something, so what is it that they've got? Well, the answer is they're all irrational. Now, the problem with this approach, apart from it being wrong, because big business did not bankroll Hitler, and because the arguments of Hitler and Mussolini were things like how we're going to reduce unemployment. That was the way they actually got a bit of substantial electoral support. Apart from this being wrong, what it meant was, and this is something you can check for yourself, if you look at left-wing writing in the 1930s, they never discuss fascism, what they call fascism, on its own terms. They're never talking to people who might be tempted by fascism and saying, this is why you shouldn't be a fascist. Instead, they're saying, there is this disease out there called fascism. And what we've got to get to take to the streets and have plenty of violence and do other things that are somehow going to stop it. And this means that rational debate, the level of rational debate sunk. People could have explained that the fall in unemployment as Hitler took power was due to earlier policies that were paying off, the policies of Bruning, people like that. They could have explained all kinds of things about economics that would have put these things in context. Now, would that have stopped fascism? Maybe not, but it certainly would have helped to make people more skeptical about it. They could have said, well, if you give all power to someone like Hitler, he might do something stupid like invade Poland. And you can be sure that big business, German big business, didn't want that. they said one thing they didn't want was for this lunatic to invade Poland. So what I'm saying here is a commitment to the idea that people are doing all kinds of things for totally irrational motives that you can't figure out. Instead of looking at what they're saying every day and saying, oh, this is the way they're thinking. How can we combat those arguments? It leads to a decline in the level of debate and a decline in effectiveness of rational people.
1855.
And you notice, I'm saying that the left were rational.
Sorry, the New York is continuing here.
Right.
Hi. Yay! Oh, thanks, Tim.
Very good.
All right.
Are you guys done?